Good morning and welcome to the fifth session of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2021. And this morning we'd like to welcome to the committee, I should mention we're meeting in a hybrid format for those of you watching in. I'd like to welcome to the committee Shirley Ann Somerville, MSP, the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, and Graham Logan, Director of Learning, the Scottish Government. This is actually the first time that we've met with the Cabinet Secretary, so we're delighted to have you with us and looking forward to a long and happy time together, working together in this important area. I understand the Cabinet Secretary intends to make a short opening statement and then we're going to go straight to questions.
Okay, thank you very much, convener, and good morning. It is a pleasure to be able to appear in front of the committee today to discuss my priorities for education for the new session. I'm deeply honoured to be serving as Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills and delighted, to return to the portfolio after being a junior minister previously. Whilst the latest data shows, thankfully, that cases have been coming down, we do, of course, remain in the midst of a pandemic, and I don't underestimate how challenging this continues to be for everyone. And I remain acutely aware of the impact it's having on the lives of our young people and on the education and skills sector as a whole. From the outset, we've been working to protect children and young people from the worst impacts of COVID-19 and to support them to recover where they have been affected. We know that some learners will have suffered adverse consequences, whether it's in terms of their health and well-being or their attainment. We will continue to address these impacts, and I'm determined that every child and young person in Scotland will have the opportunity to fulfil their potential as they progress through the education system and onto positive destinations. Yesterday, the Scottish Government published an Education Recovery at Key Actions and Next Steps document, which has been developed with input from our partners, including young people. It outlines our ongoing response to the impacts of the pandemic and sets out some of the key next steps we will take to address them. The document also draws on advice from our International Council of Education Advisers. Amongst other things, they have highlighted that the pandemic reaffirms equity as the defining issue of our time. That is why we remain committed to closing the poverty-related attainment gap in children of all ages, a core part of our wider national mission to eradicate child poverty. Whilst we continue to make good progress with this long-term ambition, I recognise that there is more to do and that the needs of individual learners should be central to our reforms. That is why we will provide £1 billion over this Parliament to close the poverty-related attainment gap and support education recovery, including a refresh of the Scottish Attainment Challenge programme from 2022-23. This will empower schools, support education recovery plans and help improve outcomes for children and young people. This autumn, I will set out to Parliament how we will refresh the attainment challenge and how this will support faster, more consistent progress to be made for learners living right across the country. Ensuring that our education system delivers for Scotland's children has arguably never been more important, which is why I've committed to a number of important reforms in this Parliament. I confirmed in June that the SQA will be replaced, and I'm minded to create a single specialist agency for curriculum and assessment. Reform of the education system aims to reduce variation in the outcomes achieved by learners and to ensure the best possible quality of support and challenge for our school environment. What comes next is a period of change, but it is change made in partnership in order to improve, to achieve more and to deliver for all of Scotland's learners. And whilst there is work to be done, I am proud of what has been accomplished this year despite all the challenges. For example, since the 1st of August, we've delivered our flagship commitment to offer 1140 funded hours of early learning and childcare to all eligible 2, 3 and 4-year-olds. And we have ambitious plans for this Parliament, expanding early learning and childcare to 1 and 2-year-olds, starting with children from low-income households. We'll also deliver on our commitment to build a system of wraparound childcare that provides care before and after school all year round. The changes we are bringing in for young people will pay dividends over their lifetime and help improve outcomes for their families. So thank you once again for the opportunity to set out the current situation in the sector, and I look forward to working with the committee on these issues in future years.
Thank you for that. We'll move straight to members' questions. Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, convener. Welcome this morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wanted to ask you about the poverty-related attainment gap. I'm wondering what lessons do you feel have been learned from the 2020-2021 session, and what plans do you have to incorporate these lessons going forward? Also, what things are you actually considering for the longer-term strategies at the moment?
Well, there is a lot we can learn from what has happened under the most difficult of circumstances. As I said in my opening remarks, one of the issues that has been very clear to all of us, and indeed with the government equity audit, that the pandemic has affected people and children and young people in particular in different ways. One of the areas we are very, very keen to move on is to ensure that we are moving further and faster with how we are dealing with attainment overall. So as we are looking at the refreshed Scottish Attainment Challenge funding, I'm determined that that looks at a number of issues. One of those will be the variation in outcomes for children and young people across Scotland. Now, variation in the way that things are done is a good thing, because we should absolutely not have a one-size-fits-all education policy. But I think everyone that has an interest in our children and young people and their achievement and attainment should be concerned about a variation in outcomes that's across the country. So it will look at that. It will look to see what can be done to speed up the efforts that are being made. As I said in my opening remarks again, we are seeing progress on the poverty-related attainment gap. We've seen that coming through clear from Audit Scotland. We've seen that being remarked by headteachers, but also Audit Scotland and education sector in general is quite rightly wanting us to do more and to do it quickly, and we are keen to do that. Part of that will be through the work of Education Scotland. One of the areas, and I give one example of you know, what we have to do from the experience of children and young people during the pandemic, is to look at digital devices, for example. And we know that there has been a great deal of work done by different local authorities to supply digital devices during the pandemic. There was also, of course, the money that went in through the recovery investment from the Scottish Government. But we do need to do more on that, which is why we have our commitment for digital devices by the end of the Parliament for every young person, because we need to be able to make sure that a child, regardless of where they are, has that ability to have that support, have that connectivity, and also that their schools have the connectivity so that the digital devices can be used by teachers in perhaps different ways than we've experienced in the past. So there is a great deal that we can learn. I think one of the aspects, again, I would take from the difficult couple of years is how the education sector as a whole has worked well collaboratively. I think this has been something that's been commented upon favourably in recent reports, and that is something that I would like to continue. I fully appreciate there will be different areas where, as politicians, we will disagree on matters on education, and indeed the education sector has a variety of views, perhaps on the way forward sometimes on different aspects. But the way that government, both national and local, unions, young people, parents and others have managed to come together, and we have worked collaboratively under the most difficult of circumstances, is something that I would very much like to see continue, because I think if we work like that, we have a much better chance of the success that we all want to see for children and young people.
That's great. Thank you very much for that. It's good to know that we're looking at what success looks like and the collaboration and engagement really taking that forward there. I also wanted to ask you about class contact time as well. The OECD report, obviously it was something that was raised there about preparation and planning. And I'm wondering if that's something as well that you think would also have an impact on the attainment gap. Will there be a focus on that there too? Thanks.
It is something which was highlighted in the report, and this is something which, as a government, we're taking very seriously. Obviously, we have a commitment to reduce class contact time for teachers by 1.5 hours per week, and that's something which is now going through due process with the SNCT, and that is something I hope that will be able to make, again, a big difference. Again, pointing back to a lesson we have learned, but I don't think it's came as a surprise to any of us that have an interest in education was, again, the professionalism and the hard work that teachers undertook to support our children and young people under the most difficult of times. But we also know that we need to support our teachers to be able to have time to be able to support our young people. And one of the ways we can do that is obviously through the reduced contact time, and we'll be moving forward with that commitment to be able to support our teachers further on that.
Thanks very much. Thank you.
Bob Dorris.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Just following on from Stephanie Callan's line of question about the last 2 years under alternative certification models, despite huge challenges, young people from the most deprived areas have got far more qualifications recognised than previous years. So that's positive, even if the scenarios they had to face were deeply, deeply harmful to them. So can I ask what you believe has been the strengths of what has been evidence-based, teacher-led professional judgment leading to certification under the alternative certification models? What have been the successes in that been? And more importantly, what are the strengths of that we shouldn't throw out once COVID is no longer with us?
Well, I think one of the strengths of that is, once again, it's demonstrated the trust that we can have in our teachers and the trust we can have in their professional judgment. I know this was a very difficult time for teachers. I know that the alternative certification model did present challenges for teachers to be able to undertake. But this was, as I think has been demonstrated, that the best system that could be in place under an emergency situation. And I think one of the, again, the lessons when I look back at all of this is it really did bring to the fore the professionalism of our teaching workforce and how they have been able to use their teacher judgment to be able to demonstrate our young people's success. And that has been absolutely critical, because at a point when exams weren't possible because of public health measures, we absolutely required a system that was credible, that was fair, and teachers have absolutely delivered on that. And I would again take this opportunity to thank them for that.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I certainly hope we bake in teachers' professional judgment into whatever replaces the current exam system and get that balance better between exit exams and what teachers see day to day, week in, week out in the classroom. Do you think that's perhaps been recognised by the SQA, who have said if exams don't go ahead next year, there'll be no dual assessment? And they, hopefully I'm interpreting this correctly, Convener, the SQA are effectively saying no dual assessment means that they have trust in this coming year about the judgments that teachers are making in this academic year, should they have to use their professional judgment to yet again give alternative certification if that's necessary. So maybe a comment on that would be helpful. Should that be baked in going forward?
Well, I think I'll take the two issues very separately, because they are separate. When we look at next year, the SQA have obviously a plan A, which is that exams will take place, and that is absolutely what we as a government, what the SQA, and importantly what schools and young people are moving forward with the teaching and learning in that. Of course, there has been discussions around contingency measures that need to be in place. For example, if the public health advice at that point said that we couldn't have an exam diet. And absolutely the teacher judgment will be absolutely at the heart of that. But the reassurance for teachers is that there's no additional assessments that need to take place. So that's different from when we were using the alternative certification model. So there's no dual assessments. Normal assessments can take place, and teachers would be able to form a judgment at the end of the year if there wasn't an exam diet based on what has taken part during a normal assessment year. On future years and what will happen in future years, that is a very separate issue that will be looked at. I'll make further announcements on that later on in the autumn, because we've obviously had the Stobart report looking at what will happen in the future. Exams, of course, will play a part in that, but I think the Stobart review has presented opportunities, questions that we'll want to look at about what that will look like in the future. But that's something not just for government, but that absolutely will be taken forward in a very much a spirit of collaboration and discussion with others. But I'll make further announcements on that in due course.
Thank you. And finally, convener, I start off my line of questioning by talking about those in the most deprived areas having a really difficult time over the last 2 years, but achieving greater certification than they had under the previous models pre-COVID. We've got the attainment challenge. You say there's a refresh of that. I welcome what more you can say in relation to that, particularly in relation to PEF monies, perhaps in relation to the new teachers, whether they'll be more likely to be deployed in deprived areas, the impact you think free school meals may have, wraparound care. A general comment on that would be helpful, Cabinet Secretary. Do you think the £20 universal credit reduction will directly impact on the poverty-related attainment gap also, Cabinet Secretary?
Well, I won't say too much, if you'll forgive me, convener, about the attainment challenge and the refresh of that, because I will be making further announcements in due course on that. What I can say is to reassure committee that very much at the heart of that will remain the empowerment of schools to be able to take decisions, because, for example, through the money, through PEF, they know their communities best and they know how best to use that funding to support the children and young people that they're there to support. I think one of the challenges we will have as a government, as we look to tackling the poverty-related attainment gap, is obviously we can do so much in education. We're determined to absolutely do that. But the other area, of course, is to actually tackle child poverty. Now, I'm working very closely with my colleague Shona Robison to see what can be done on our portfolios around that. But then you have the UK government, of course, taking away the equivalent of the Scottish Child Payment through the universal credit cut. And that inevitably will have an impact on children and families right across the country, which will therefore inevitably have an impact on how they can perhaps prepare for school. Now, the government can do what it can through the school clothing grant, through free school meals, etc., to be able to support children and young people, but it doesn't help when part of our support is then taken away by another hand.
Okay, I'm just checking, convener. Not on universal credit, that point's well made. I don't want to explore that any further. But PEF's under the attainment challenge. PEF is here to stay because it made a real difference to the schools in my constituency. And can you say a little bit more about the teacher numbers, the additional teachers? Will they just be for local authorities to deploy as they see fit, or will there be a real motivation to direct them to perhaps schools in more deprived low-income areas to really assist with that attainment challenge? And that's my final question, convener.
So when we're looking at the attainment challenge, I will of course look at there's different funding streams within that, and I will look to see whether that is the most effective use of that. And I know when I met various committee members at the start of my time as Education Secretary, people had different opinions on how that might be done in the future, which I've listened to. But something which I think has been a key part of the attainment challenge overall has been the ability for head teachers to be able to make direct decisions. Mm-hmm. And that's something that will absolutely remain. With regard to teacher numbers, of course, the commitment for the government is for 3,500 additional teachers during this parliamentary term. That sits separate and in addition to the Scottish Attainment Challenge Fund. So that is not part of my discussions around the attainment challenge, but that will be something that will just go through the usual process of the funding being distributed to local authorities on that issue.
Okay, thank you.
And how, Cabinet Secretary, how are you making sure that these new teaching positions are actually permanent contracts? I mean, I know there was an agreement during the summer in relation to the permanence of the funding for teachers. How is the government following through? Are you measuring? Because at one point, when I asked the parliamentary question recently, 1 in 8 teachers in Scotland were on temporary contracts. Clearly, that's something we all agree needs to be changed. How is the Scottish Government monitoring that and measuring it?
Yeah, I think, if my memory serves me correct, convener, the written question that was given to you also included teachers that might have been on a permanent contract but that were in a temporary position. So we just need to use some of those figures with caution on that. In saying that, however, there is absolutely a concern which I've heard loud and clear from teachers directly about the number of teachers that are on actual temporary contracts. Mm-hmm. That's why I've taken action to baseline the funding that has been part of our COVID recovery strategy. So we've now seen that baselined in, and obviously the money that's coming in for the 3,500 additional teachers over this parliamentary term is additional. I am, as I'm sure the committee would expect, keeping an exceptionally close eye on the fact that those are additional teachers and that they are permanent contracts. Now, that is something for local government as the employer to do. I can't insist that they are on permanent contract. I think what I would say is there is no reason, if the money has been baselined, for those teachers not to be on permanent contracts. But it is something we are keeping an exceptionally close eye on, and I'm sure the committee would expect.
Good to hear that, as we all are. Willie Rennie.
I think certainly baselining that funding for the teachers will help. I think that's right. I hope that you would also look at the PEF funding, because obviously that's allocated on an annual basis and obviously has an impact on the temporary arrangements that are available to schools. So hopefully you'll look at that issue as well. But I want to turn to the Scottish National Standardised Assessments. The OECD on page 128 of the report stated the purpose and usefulness of these assessments are already being questioned, and they told us that the SNSA is not considered by our team as the most appropriate system monitoring mechanism. So are you going to stop collecting the assessment data across the country?
So I've listened very carefully to the discussions around what's been said in the OECD report and then what was said afterwards. I think what we have to bear in mind is, I think, the reasons for having national standardised assessments, what they do and what they cannot do and were never expected to do. So the purpose of the national standardised assessments is primarily formative. It's there to provide a very important and valuable diagnostic information to teachers on children's progress. So that's what they are there to do. With regards to what they can't do, what they were never designed to do, they were never designed to be the measure of everything in curriculum for excellence. That's why there's different data that is gathered within schools to be able to support that through the National Improvement Framework, for example. So I've looked very carefully at what the OECD have said. I've looked very carefully at the information that was gathered, which predated me in the Priestley review, for example, into the review of the standardised assessments. And we are seeing an increased use of them by teachers, and they are finding them more useful as the years have gone on. And I think that is another important part that we need to look at is, you know, what are they there for? And are teachers finding them useful for what they are designed to do? And as we see from some of the work that's coming through from teachers, they are finding them useful as part of that formative assessment.
I've got I've got no doubt formative assessments have been used for generations in schools. I understand that. My issue is that you collect them and you produce a national report, and that national report is now leading to crude league tables being published. And in fact, one of the First Minister's schools in her own constituency was highlighted as one of the apparently worst performing schools in the country. I don't believe it for a minute. I believe that school is probably performing well, but because of their demographics and their background, it's assessed as one of the worst schools. Now, that surely can't be good for the Scottish education system. If you stopped collecting this data on a national basis, stopped using it for monitoring purposes, and allowed teachers to continue to use it at a local level, surely that would be the best of all worlds. So why aren't you stopping collecting the information?
So I think it's very important that we do have data and we have the correct data, and that allows teachers to be able to make an informed judgment about how well a pupil is progressing. It allows head teachers to be able to assess what's happening within their schools. I think at a local authority level, it's also useful for that. And it's important that we have information at a government level to see, again, as I was discussing earlier, if there's a concern around the variation of outcomes for children. So I think it is important that we gather data so that we can ensure that every child, regardless of where they are in Scotland, has the right opportunities and we're not seeing a variation in outcomes. Now, just to be clear, what we actually collect is curriculum for excellence levels. We don't collect and publish the standardised assessments. Now, those are two very different aspects of it. And I think, again, it goes back to what data is being collected, what it's therefore being used for, and how useful it's proving for different parts of the system. Now, I think it is right, and I think there's nothing in the OECD report which says we shouldn't be collecting data at national levels. The challenge they've given us is, are we collecting the right data, and are we doing the right things with it? And so I would make the distinction about standardised assessments and the data we collect at a national level and how we use it.
Just one final point on this. There is, I mean, we have heard evidence from others that a survey like the survey of literacy and numeracy that used to take place, it wasn't perfect and it could have been improved. But that kind of survey, that census approach, is better than the use of data, which includes the SNSAs as part of this framework, to make the assessment of performance of schools and individuals, is not the right way to do it. We should be returning to a survey approach. So why won't you consider that, so we can stop having these crude league tables that I think demoralise schools and pupils?
Well, to be absolutely clear, the Scottish Government does not and will not ever produce league tables for schools.
You provide the data for it.
Well, it's important that we have data. So if Mr Rennie's saying we shouldn't have any data at a national level to allow us to decide whether, you know, there's an issue about variation of outcomes, he's perfectly entitled to that viewpoint.
Don't misunderstand me. I'm in favour of data, but I'm not in favour of individual data being available on schools, which can be turned into league tables. I understand you don't produce the league tables, but newspapers have done so, and they can only do so because you're publishing the data. Why don't you produce surveys on that basis, which is a far superior system? I just don't understand why you're continuing with this policy when it's been criticised quite widely by a number of people.
Well, he may say it's been criticised quite widely, but in the 2015 review of education in Scotland, the OECD said the sample approach of the SNLN didn't give national agencies enough evidence. So, you know, we have been told by the OECD in the past that sampling doesn't provide the right evidence to allow national agencies to be able to take the right decisions and the right course of action. So I think there is absolutely a balance around sampling and the type of sample data. We do, of course, continue to participate in the largest international survey, PISA, but we do, I think, have to look very, very carefully at, did sampling provide us with the information required? And we've got from the OECD in 2015 a suggestion that light sampling of literacy and numeracy at the national level has not provided sufficient evidence for other stakeholders to use in their own evaluative activities, or for national agencies to identify with confidence the areas of strength in the years of the broad general education across the four capacities of CFE. nor has it allowed identification of those aspects or localities where intervention might be needed. So there's a direct quote from the OECD saying caution on the use of sampling. So there has to be some sampling and some census.
The crucial word on that was light sampling. You could have heavier sampling and still keep a sampling model rather than the current model you've adopted that allows crude league tables to be published.
Well, I think it is very important that we have the information that we do use around curriculum for excellence levels, and that is a pupil-by-pupil basis, so that teachers, schools, national agencies know what happens within our schools. If we don't have that, then it is exceptionally difficult at a national level, or even, I would suggest, at a local government level, to be able to make the correct decisions about where more support might be required, about where there's perhaps support for a school within terms of more staffing or additional funding may wish to go in or additional initiative. It is difficult to be able to do that if we don't have the data at the level that we're producing it. So it has to be a balance. I'm absolutely very conscious of the fact that there is a variety of different views on the use of sample data, on the use of census data. It is something which, as we respond to the OECD survey, we will, of course, have recommendations which the OECD have given us in this report, of the recommendation that the quote I gave out there was from a previous report, which we will look at very, very carefully. So I'm not saying that there is nothing we should be doing on data and that I'm in a fixed position over absolutely everything on it. We should always challenge ourselves to make sure that there is we are collecting the right data in the right way and it's being used effectively.
So finally on this, the OECD were very clear that even though it wasn't in the headline recommendations, the text underneath those headline recommendations did have some significant criticism of your current data collection process. So do you accept that recommendation?
So I will look at the OECD report in its entirety. You know, I haven't, my official haven't just read the executive summary and the recommendations. We have read the report substantial as it is. So of course I've looked at every single aspect of that report. What I've said to you then in my previous answer is that I will, you know, challenge myself, you know, we will challenge ourselves as we move forward with the OECD review response in full about whether there's more that needs to be done on data to make sure that people have confidence in what's being collected and it's being done in the right way. But I think, again, we go back to being clear about what the OECD report said around standardised assessments. I would again go back to what I said at the start about standardised assessments are never there to judge the totality of curriculum for excellence. That was never their point. That's not what they're designed to do. And therefore, it's not surprising that they don't do that.
Okay. Cool, Cap.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning, Mr. Logan, as well. We've already taken evidence and we all listened very carefully regarding the alternative certification model from young people and from the unions. And there was obviously a wee bit of concern that came through regarding too many assessments in too short a time. So I was hoping that the Cabinet Secretary this morning could give us an indication of what stakeholder engagement the Scottish Government has undertaken to listen to the views of young people and unions in order to inform contingency planning for the year ahead.
So this work sits very nicely into what the SQA has done, although obviously as a government minister, I have regular discussions with stakeholders on this issue and to share a variety of other issues, as do my officials. What the SQA have established last year was the National Qualifications 21 group, which had a representation on it from union representatives, from parents and from young people. Now, where possible, There was an attempt to achieve consensus during that, and for the vast majority of that, with the exception, I think, of appeals, there was a consensus about how to use that. Clearly then, there was a discussion about how the SQA could improve that process for next year. And one of the ways which I think Fiona Robertson spoke about when she was here was around ensuring there's a greater voice and capacity for young people to have their say. So that group is exceptionally important. It allows things to be aired at length. And it meets exceptionally regularly and continues to meet to make sure that they're still discussing the contingencies that are in place. So I think what's been established by the SQA last year was a good example of how stakeholders can work together. And I'm pleased that the SQA then looked at that, refreshed it for what more can be done this year, particularly to bring in young people more on this aspect. That doesn't necessarily mean to say there'll be agreement on all of these aspects of it, but I think the process is one which allows everyone to have their say. Of course, as government minister, as I said, I have a clear line of sight to stakeholders myself as they input into their discussions around that, and it's something, for example, that we discuss at various times at the Education Recovery Group, which I co-chair with Councillor McCabe, and those things are brought up there and again refreshed and discussed if stakeholders wish to do so.
That's great. I'm also sort of mindful of staff as well. So looking at this academic year 2021-22 and the three scenarios that are outlined there, what safeguards have been considered to prevent additional workload on staffing?
This was something which has been discussed at great length in the NQ22 group, as it now is, over this. Clearly there were understandable concerns about the workload pressures which the alternative certification model presented to staff last year. We're not in that circumstance this year. We're not doing the alternative certification model this year. So the key point that has been looked at and which we have now got a discussion around is what are the contingencies and a reassurance that there's no additional assessments that are required that teachers have to carry out. I think that's very, very important reassurance to teachers because, as I say, they are still in the midst of dealing with the pandemic. And I think there was very much a keenness both from government and the SQA to ensure we were taking cognizance of the impact that decisions would have on teacher workload.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, Skills Development Scotland is a national body within your remit, responsible for skills investment plans and regional skills assessments. So there have been regional skills assessments conducted for Edinburgh and South East Scotland, Highlands and Islands, and Aberdeen City and Shire. When will regional skills assessments be conducted for the rest of Scotland?
So I don't think I've got that information with me, Convener, about when the actual assessments will take place for other areas of the country, so it's perhaps something that
could you write
I can
to me
provide
with the,
in writing.
Write to the committee with that information? I mean, clearly, we all have our own local interests at heart, and I would be particularly keen to know in Central Scotland will figure in this.
Noted, Convener.
This work, which is vital. Now, skills gaps are not a new story in our economy. You can go back to any year in the last 20 and find warnings and reports about skills gaps. And certainly we now face a challenge with those skills gaps as our economy restarts. To what extent do you think that these skills gaps are structural? What's stopping us from training people into these shortage areas? I'm thinking specifically, if I may be more, elaborate a bit more. In 2014, the Care Commission highlighted shortages of trained staff in social care. There's been various reports about hospitality. And in digital, there's a particular crunch. So what is stopping us? Is it structural? What is stopping us getting our people trained?
Well, I think you raise a very important point, Convener. It's something which has been a challenge pre-pandemic, but certainly has been a challenge because of the pandemic, and I would have to say accentuated because of the impact of Brexit in many areas as well. So we are seeing vacancies and gaps over particular areas. I think one of the key...
It's not specifically, as you say, a new phenomenon, though, is it? I mean, I've got reports here. I can go back 20 years. I mean, there's been series of reports. So I don't think we should get too caught up in any current issues. This is a structural issue, isn't it?
Forgive me, Convener, I think there's a variety of sectors right across the country. We would absolutely say that some of the skills gaps have been accentuated because of Brexit. I think that's, I don't think that's too much of a political point and merely a statement of fact. But there are issues that have been going on for some time in certain areas. One of the aspects you've raised, Convener, quite rightly, is around digital, for example, and that has been something which has been a challenge ongoing. One of the areas that we're very keen to work on to ensure that there are no structural challenges at a national level that is having an impact on that is around ensuring that SDS and the Scottish Funding Council work very well together so that we are assessing skills gaps and therefore what's happening within our education sector. So part of the skills alignment work that has been done is very, very important in this aspect to make sure that at government level, are our national agencies working as effectively as they can do, both from a skills point of view and an education's point of view, and making sure that they work very well together. One of the other areas, of course, we will need to look at as we move out of COVID is the challenge that we have around providing support to key sectors. So that's why, for example, we've had National Transition Training Funds. That's why we've got the Flexible Workforce Development Fund and individual training accounts. And this year, we'll evaluate the Flexible Workforce Development Fund and ITAs to assess whether there's again more that can be done to simplify, to strengthen that lifelong learning offer, again to challenge ourselves to see whether there's more that we can do on that. With regards to the digital shortages, there is of course a great deal of work going on just specifically in that sector, which I probably don't have too much time to go into at committee today, but happy to give further evidence to committee on that by writing if it would help both to deal with some of the short-term challenges that we have seen and also a competitive market that we have that's leaving it difficult, for example, for small firms to be able to take part in it. So we're looking very closely at a national level, at a government level, to see what needs to be done in terms of our funding streams and in terms of our national agencies to make sure that we're providing that effective support to people when they need it.
I hear what you're saying, but would you mind if I ask you the same question? What's your analysis of what's been stopping us to this point? You've talked a lot about the present and the future, but what's your analysis of why we have such skills shortages that go back so far? What is it that... let me ask you bluntly. I mean, is Skills Development Scotland fulfilling its role? I mean, is that organisation an organisation that you should be looking closely at in the same way as we're looking at the SQA and Education Scotland?
I can assure you, Convener, I keep a very close eye on all the agencies that are under my remit. Yes, I think SDS are working effectively. But what I've tried to lay out in that answer is we're not taking anything for granted. That's why we're assessing the packages that are on to see if they're fit for purpose. And that's why SDS and the Funding Council, I think one of the areas where we know we need to do better is around the skills alignment to make sure the skills packages and the education packages that we're
I'm still not hearing an analysis of what has stopped us to this point. I mean, to be able to fix something, you've got to know what it is you're trying to fix. What are we trying to fix? Why are we not succeeding in training Scots for these highly skilled jobs in many cases?
Part of the challenge is for some of the areas, they are not highly paid jobs. So, for example, one of the areas where we might attract people into social care, for example, is having a better fair work policy and a better standard of pay, for example, mm-hmm. that some mm-hmm. of the announcements that were made by the Health Secretary yesterday on that. Of course, some of the areas around employment or fair work are reserved to Westminster. So I think we have areas in low-paid work mm-hmm. where we have a challenge because maybe the actual sectors aren't an attractive offer mm-hmm. given the wages that are being paid at that point. And one of the ways that that could be assisted with is if the real living wage was mm-hmm. at a more substantial level. Some of the other areas where we're having challenges is around ensuring that we have people skilled up correctly. So one of the examples that we've looked at during the pandemic, in which we're very interested to see what more can be done around, is micro-credential courses, so therefore allowing people to move perhaps from one sector to another or to upskill that will actually allow people to mm-hmm. support the skill needs across the economy. So again, one of the reasons why we're assessing what's been happening at the moment is how successful have those micro-credential courses been? Has that allowed for upskilling? Has it allowed for people to change courses, for example, in terms of their careers, when we're looking at the National Transitional Training Fund? So I think it is important that we assess what we're doing right just now, because part of our challenge...
You're doing right, yes, I agree, but also what's gone wrong?
Well, that's
because
why,
clearly things have gone wrong.
Yeah, that's why we're assessing it.
Look, we can have longer conversations about this, I'm sure. I want to make sure we get my colleagues in. But Michael Marr has been jumping up and down here in the corner. I want to get him in.
Thank you, Kavir. I mean, I'm quite animated by this issue around digital skills, and as it pertains particularly to my home city of Dundee, but more broadly across the country. I mean, I'm just pretty unconvinced by your analysis of that, if I can say, Cabinet Secretary. I mean, we have a situation where computer games training or computer courses in universities cannot put in place computing hires as a compulsory subject requirement because we can't get kids hires because there isn't enough teachers. So, I mean, as much as there's this issue about SDS, and, you know, I think that's a reasonable statement from the convener, I mean, there's much more in your portfolio that pertains to this specific issue. And these are not low-paid jobs. These are absolutely high-paid, the jobs of the future that could be attracting investment.
Yep. So...
Good, right.
So I said over the digital one, I'd be happy to provide further discussion, but happy to get into it a little bit more because I do think this is an area, as I said, use some of the examples around lower paid jobs. I would stress they are not lower skilled jobs, but lower paid jobs. But there's an area around digital which is key, but that's exactly why we've had the Logan Review that's looked at this particular issue in particular. Spoken directly to Mark Logan about this issue and about the education issue in that, and when we were having our discussions on that, there was an agreement that that my officials would work with him to again see what more could be done in the education sector, because I absolutely take your point. I've got no issue with your assessment at all about the challenge we have of ensuring that we have the right skills within the teaching profession to be able to provide the courses to allow people to go into university. That's one of the aspects, just one of the aspects within the Logan Review, and it is something which he and I have discussed about what we need to do on that. So I would absolutely agree that it's a point that more needs to be done on, and I think it's an area where we are very keen to work with him to see what more can be done and collaboratively in that and what we do need to change. Part of the challenge is about attracting people into the teaching profession that may have other employment opportunities out there if they have the type of kind of computing background and they may not see teaching as the attractive option in that, and that's one of the areas amongst many we're looking at on that.
Thank you for that. I'm sure this is an issue that we will return to time and time again. Ross Greer.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I'd like to return to the conversation you were having with COCAB, Stuart, around the National Qualifications Group. And just start off by asking, have you spoken since the 2021 ACM experience, have you spoken to Cameron Garrett, the MSYP, who was quite critical of his experience on that group, or to Bruce Adamson, the Children's Commissioner, who was scathing about the claims of co-production by young people?
So I haven't spoken to the Commissioner, but I have heard what he has to say on it. Most of my discussions are with Liam, who's on the Education Recovery Group. He's made very clear the discussions that's been had about the concerns about the NQ21, now NQ22 group. And I think this is one of the areas where we need to be very, very careful as a government. So I've listened very carefully to what the Commissioner said about being careful. I think he probably put it more strongly that about the types of wording that we use. So when we say co-design, genuinely meaning co-design, it's one of the areas where I'm keen that we're doing a lot more as a government. So that's exactly why I've set up the Children and Young People's Education Council that will have parity with the Education Council that's been refreshed and will meet soon, so that children and young people have a voice. I am acutely conscious, given my experience and my previous belief in social security, you can have people at the table. It doesn't mean that they feel empowered to have their voice heard at that point. It doesn't mean that they're facilitated to have their voice heard at that point. And that's a lesson that, regardless of where it is in government, we need to absolutely learn and take cognizance of. So I very much think that I have listened. I'm quite happy to be told by the Commissioner otherwise if we need to do more on it. But I think we have listened to the criticisms that were there. Now, that doesn't mean that we will agree with a children and young person's representative on a panel. So there was areas around the appeals process for 2021, for example, that I fundamentally had a disagreement with the points that were being put forward about a no detriment policy on that. But I think the key point is, did any young person in this process, did they feel they had the right opportunity to have their say and be listened to? Not that I'm going to agree with them, but did they feel that? And they clearly didn't at that point. And that's something I have taken exceptionally seriously, but I hope have demonstrated that we've taken action on since.
Thank you. Moving on to the announcement last week that the Qualities and Human Rights Commission have used their statutory powers to intervene at the Scottish Qualifications Authority. What conversations have you had with the SQA since you became aware of the EHRC's enforcement actions? And what action are you taking to ensure that the public sector equality duty is being met by the agencies that are accountable to you?
So this is something I take exceptionally seriously. We do expect the equalities duties to be taken seriously and to be undertaken thoroughly across our agencies. I last spoke to the Chief Examiner on Monday of this week to discuss this issue. And to again be reassured by her about the work that is in place now to ensure that everything that has needs to be done is being done on this issue. I am reassured that all the required equality impacts assessments regarding the awarding of the national qualifications over the last 2 years were completed and have been published. And that's in addition to those that were published by the Scottish Government. But clearly, there has been a substandard practice in years gone by that's been recognised, and those historic policies are now being looked at and actioned.
How do you believe that came about? Because I struggle to understand it. My interpretation of what's happened is not that EQIAs took place but were unsatisfactory, but that they, on a regular basis, simply weren't taking place at all, which for a very simple statutory duty stuns me. And I accept that this all happened long before you came into the role that you're in now, but what is your understanding of how that came about? Had this simply always been a deficiency at the SQA since the public sector equality duty was brought into place, or did it gradually fade away as the members of staff responsible for it moved on to other posts or other jobs? How did this possibly come about?
Well, I think that's one of the areas where the SQ will absolutely need to learn lessons. And there's, again, lessons for all of government to ensure that these situations never happen. I think it should be clear, it doesn't just predate my time in post, but this is an issue which really does predate the time of the current Chief Examiner in post as well. She is very, very keen to ensure that the SQA are fulfilling its duties. She knows that this is an area which, understandably and quite rightly, people are concerned about. That's exactly why they're already in a process within the SQA about completing all the outstanding AQIs. So, for example, there's been 28 new equality impact assessments already published since August. So there is work to make sure that this is alleviated. But I think this is very much something which I am sure, having spoken to the Chief Examiner, she is very, very keen to ensure that they have practices and policies in place to ensure that we never get into a position where there is even a doubt that these obligations aren't happening.
Thank you. I believe there are other colleagues looking to come in on this issue. So just briefly, there's one more issue that I'd like to touch on. I'm not sure if you were aware, but I think the First Minister misheard my question yesterday during the COVID statement on school ventilation. So I'm just essentially going to repeat it. If you may have that information, but if not, if you could write to the committee, be appreciated. So the deadline for making ventilation improvements in schools is, I believe, next Friday, certainly next week. Could you confirm how much of the money that was allocated has been spent, and if a report will be produced, will be available to Parliament, breaking down that allocation by local authority and how each local authority spent the money? And finally, how will the effectiveness of the ventilation improvements be monitored? How will we know that they're actually working and making classrooms safer?
Yeah. So I did hear that the First Minister, I think, answered an entirely different point to Mr. Greer. I think she misheard the question and answered it about small businesses.
Yes.
So I came in preparation that you might try again today. The distribution of the £10 million has been agreed through COSLA leaders. So each local authority will receive an equitable share of the funding on the strict understanding it's for the purpose of improving ventilation. So that includes covering the cost of monitors and so on. So that will be processed through the local government settlement. The capital element will be provided to local authorities as a one-off payment in November, and the revenue element will be provided in March, as is the normal practice. There's been great strides taken by local authorities on this to take their initial monitoring before the October holidays, which aren't all at the same time, I would stress, obviously within Scotland, but they are making good progress to allow that to happen. There are some local authorities that are reporting concerns, for example, around supply issues, which we always knew may be a challenge in some areas. But what we have been doing is working very closely with COSLA, but to give advice on procurement routes for quick supply, and also brokering discussions between local authorities to arrange the loan of mobile devices, for example, if that's feasible, when some councils are perhaps further ahead on this. In the round, once the October holidays have begun, we will then collate that final position. And then I am anticipating providing a report later in October, which will allow an assessment of how that work has progressed. And we will be keeping a very close eye then on what happens after October once the initial monitoring has taken place.
Thank you. Look forward to that report. That's all from me for now, Convener.
Thank you. Thank you, Ross. Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Convener. I want to ask the Cabinet Secretary when she was first made aware that there had been breaches of the SQA's public sector equality duty.
I was made aware of that a few weeks ago, prior to the public announcement being made.
Thank you. You'll have seen Fiona Robertson's appearance at this committee last week. As a member of this Parliament, do you think it's acceptable that she omitted to mention these issues when being questioned directly about how the SQA achieves equality?
I think this is an area where clearly there has been a concern around the timing of the report into this, and the fact it was the day after Fiona Robertson was here. I would absolutely like to make clear it was not the SQA's decision on the timing of the publication of that report. There had been hope to actually publish the report earlier, which would have been before Ms Robertson's appearance, but it was not the decision of the SQA to have the date that was finally settled on. That was an issue for the Commission itself. So I would agree it is disappointing that that didn't happen so that Ms Robertson could discuss those issues, but to be absolutely clear, that was not of the SQA's making.
The SQA might not be responsible for that, but clearly over the past 2 years there's been chaos. The OECD have identified that the organisation's not fit for purpose. We now know that there have been discriminative practices. You and the First Minister have both given this Parliament your reassurance that the SQA had your full backing. Do you regret that?
The OECD have not said that the SQA is not fit for purpose. I think we need to be very, very careful about putting words into the mouths of the OECD. I don't think that's a position which is a comfortable one for anyone within this Parliament. What the OECD have pointed to is that we can look to having a different type of organisation in place through curriculum and assessment. That's exactly the recommendation that I've looked at and that I have acted upon. In the meantime, while the work carries on through the Ken Muir report into what will replace the SQA and any reforms for Education Scotland, both Education Scotland and the SQA have a very important role to do. I think it is exceptionally important that the SQA carries on that work to ensure that we have credible and fair exams and assessment system next year. I have full confidence that they will continue to do that, and I have full confidence in the SQA.
I hear what the Cabinet Secretary is saying, but I don't understand how it's possible for her to retain confidence in an organisation that's been responsible for a catalogue of errors and shown such poor judgment. Is it not time for the Cabinet Secretary to step in and assume day-to-day responsibility for decision-making at the SQA so that young people can have absolute assurance that their interests would be protected? And I can say that the Scottish Conservatives would support any measures that needed to come forward in order to make that possible, given the organisation's likely to remain in place, not just this academic year, but also next.
Can I say with the greatest respect to Oliver Mundell, it would be utterly inappropriate for a politician of any colour to actually have direct control of qualification credits within their country. I mean, it is absolutely key that a qualifications agency is independent of government. That allows the system to be a credible one and outside political interference. So I do not intend to take over day-to-day control of the SQA. What we absolutely, of course, as a government will ensure we have is a very close working relationship with the SQA as and when it's appropriate to ensure that we have the working relationship that people would expect. And I'm sure the committee would expect me to be able to work closely, challenge where appropriate, the Chief Examiner on different issues as we go through this. But the SQA has been able to ensure over the last year that there has been a fair and credible system that has allowed young people to be able to receive their qualifications under the most difficult of circumstances. So I will be very careful to keep a close working relationship, to challenge where necessary. I don't think, given my time in this remit so far, people could ever criticise me for not keeping a close eye on the SQA. But I will do that very closely and ensuring that the correct distinction is made between where there has to be independence of the SQA as well.
Well, I've heard that answer. Just a final question on a different topic. a national newspaper had an advanced draft of the Education Recovery Plan back on the 14th of August. Given it's so uninspiring, why was its publication held back to yesterday? And have you, to ask you bluntly, I mean, have you given up on serious reform of Scottish education?
So I don't think genuinely anyone that's followed what I've been doing since coming into portfolio would suggest I've given up on reform. It's really been quite a busy time for reform within the education system within that. Previous drafts of the education paper that came out yesterday have been shared amongst members of the Education Recovery Group on numerous occasions as we've gone through this. It has been a document that we've shared quite widely with our stakeholders as we've gone through this. And what I would say to Oliver Mundell is, genuinely, if he has proposals for different policies that he would want to come forward with this, I'm again more than happy to meet him, as I said at the very start of my tenure as Education Secretary, about what he may wish to see, the budget process which we're about to begin. If he doesn't like what is in the material which came out yesterday, then I look forward to seeing the proposals that the Conservatives will bring forward on this issue. But I think what the document was yesterday was a collation of what the government is doing, because, funnily enough, the government didn't start thinking about recovery in education over the past month. It's been something that's been very, very close into our minds right before the election. That's exactly why we've been putting a lot of these measures in place. This government was elected on a manifesto which was designed to assist the country through recovery from the pandemic, which again makes it unsurprising that the recovery programme that we had within our manifesto plays loud and strong in that. What we have done is ensure that what we have is policies that are in place that are turning their full attention to that. So again, for example, the Scottish Attainment Challenge is not new, but of course it has been looked at to ensure that it's taken all the lessons from the pandemic. So when the Scottish Attainment Challenge refresh, I make more announcements on that, it is not the same types of policy and funding streams that we've seen in the past, because we are moving on. So of course we're using the different policy levers that we've had for some time and turning it to the attention of the pandemic. I don't think the committee would expect anything less.
I think the committee might have expected, like schools, that the plan would have been ready for schools going back in August, not published in October, the day before you came here. But I'll move on and let other members come in.
Thank you, Oliver. Michael Mara.
Thank you, Convener. I mean, this unholy mess, really, at the SQA doesn't emerge overnight. Statutory powers by the HRC are not isn't the first action they would take. The organisation would have chances to reform, numerous chances to reform their practices over that period. So I have been told that this relates to 112 policies at the SQA, including awarding meetings for national courses, awarding body approval policy, equality of access to SQA qualifications, grading for national courses, the qualifications framework, Disclosure Scotland policy, and the SQA skills framework, all of which pertain as overarching policies to the last 2 years. Can I ask what analysis has been done by your officials about whether this opens the Scottish Government to any potential legal challenge from young people who may feel they've been let down?
So I understand that Mr Mara has received a list from the SQA of the areas of policy that still need to have an AQIA. What I would urge some caution on is he has a list of the policy headlines for it. But what I would, again, hopefully reassure the committee on is that I have spoken directly to the Chief Examiner on this issue. There has been ongoing discussions with the SQA and my officials in this. And again, I would repeat that I have had a reassurance that there is nothing that is outstanding that has implications on the awards that have been given over the past 2 years. These are historical practices that have gone on. These are historical policies, but I have sought and been given the reassurance that the types of policies that they remain outstanding on have not had any implications on awards. Now, there are a number of areas where the type of agreement that happens between an organisation and the Commission is a signed legal agreement. There's confidentiality around that about what can be publicised on this. And again, my understanding is that the SQA have sought and got agreement from the Commission about that list being able to be made published, because it is done very much as an attempt to reassure that they are attempting to be as transparent as possible while abiding to the legal agreement that has... I appreciate where Mr. Mann is coming from, and I would wish that there is perhaps more that could be said by the SQA on this. The SQA has to seek agreement from the Commission to be able to make areas around this public. And I don't think that's a comfortable position for the SQA either, because I think they would maybe wish to be able to reassure people more than it's possible,
which is why
they've tried to do it through getting this list and being able to make that available to Mr. Mara.
And I think transparency would have meant trying to do something at committee to highlight this fact under direct questioning regarding equalities issues, that this was something that had been coming for a very long time. I hear the Cabinet Secretary when she says that this has to be done in agreement. I'll look forward to seeing the correspondence between the SQA and the EHRC when they asked for that to be brought forward so they could do it before committee. Can I move on to an associated issue? I mean, I think my view, and I think shared by other members of the committee and certainly by members of the public who have spoken to the performance of the leadership to SQA and in front of our committee last week, was poor, frankly, before this came out the next day. I had representations from the trade unions who wrote to you at the start of September and received what they characterised the 21st of September as an appalling response about their ongoing role and submission they made to you about the terms of reference of the reform process, and you say you're very interested in that reform. I've looked at that response and I would share their characterisation of it. Can you give them assurances in terms of the comments they made about the hundreds of members of staff who have been ignored by the leadership of the SQA throughout the last 2 years, and particularly over the debacle of the algorithm, as to whether their viewpoints have been taken into that reform process and how you are doing that?
So just to be clear, the intention, as I understand it, was for the report to be out before the committee appearance of Fiona Robertson, but there was a requirement for it to be changed in date by the Commission, and therefore that was a decision made by the Commission. It couldn't be changed by the SQA. So just to be clear,
we'll
that,
wait and see the correspondence,
that what happens, that's fine. Well, they can't ask for it to be brought forward if the Commission say for legal, for reasons they have to have a delay for it, because that's the reason behind that. Now, in terms of the terms of reference of the review, and in terms of the feelings of the unions on this and of staff, I fully appreciate that when I made the announcement to replace the SQA, that it would be a time of great concern for the staff that's there. They are exceptionally passionate about their jobs. They are good at their job. And there is clearly a concern as we go through this process about how they can be heard from it. Now, there was a number of points that were made by different stakeholders when we were looking at the draft terms of reference for Ken Muir to come into position. Again, as with all these processes, not all the suggestions of changes can be made to a terms of reference. But I hope what the unions have seen since Ken Muir came into post is that the unions will absolutely have an ability to have direct discussions with Ken Muir. My understanding is that that's happened already, and I'm sure it will continue to happen, although that is a process for Ken Muir decide on. All staff will have abilities to feed into the process of the review as well. So it is very much not the fact that it will be, you know, senior management that will be led to have discussions with Ken Muir, and the staff will be kept separate, or there will be one voice of the SQA that will assume to be representing all staff. All staff, unions, and as people would expect, senior management and the board will have their ability to have their say in this review process.
And you'll understand, Cabinet Secretary, when the chief executive of an organisation who leads that organisation welcomes the announcement that organisation is to be folded and gotten rid of, that the many hundreds of staff who work for that individual and who she is charged with leading would be incredibly disappointed. I think that's a dereliction of leadership, in actual fact, when this came forward in terms of your announcement, and then it was welcomed by Ms. Robertson, Dr. Robertson, apologies. And I think they have made clear that they want to have separate representation on that body, and they do not have faith in the leadership of the SQA to represent their expert opinion and their experience. So I would hope that you might consider that and take it forward and write again to the trade unions on that basis.
Can I just make clear, they do have the ability to have direct discussions with Ken Muir and his work. There's nothing stopping the unions having direct discussions with them. My understanding is those discussions have happened already. There have already been discussions. So I don't need to interfere in that process because there's nothing stopping them from having
I think by the correspondence that I've had, it sounds like I've had contact with them more recently than you, Cabinet Secretary. So just on that basis, I think it would be good if you might follow up with them and check that that process is as you described and they're satisfied with it.
I will certainly undertake that and get back to you in writing. I can assure you I've had very regular conversations with my officials on this.
Superb. My last point on the separate issue, if I can, Convener. In the evidence that we took in the conversations we had with pupils across Scotland, there was a significant theme that I thought emerged from it, relating to, they've all been very concerned about qualifications, as we all have, in terms of what's come from that. But the challenge of what they have learned over these last 2 years, so a huge gap in the amount of time that they've had out of school. Have you and your officials undertaken an assessment of the knowledge and learning gaps that have taken place over the last, and the impact of that, and has that informed your recovery plan?
So it in many ways refers back to one of my earlier answers to Willie Rennie around what is collated, and part of that is the Curriculum for Excellence levels data that we gather to be able to assess where young people are at in their progress along this. One of the aspects we're obviously very keen to ensure is it is very important to look at what's been learned over this, and the data is there. It's also very, very important to look at the health and well-being of young people through this process as well. And there is, I think in December, there's another survey that's out on health and well-being. To be able to assure ourselves about where we're at with this aspect as well. But we would, of course, expect government to be able to keep a close eye on this, not just because of the pandemic, but just in general. So the National Improvement Framework Interactive Evidence Report provides an overview of what we know about education and the context where they are at. So that is work that is being looked at. There's also work underway to gather additional evidence for the 2022 NIF from the lockdown lowdown survey, as well as head teacher surveys and the health and wellbeing census that I mentioned, that's from P5 to S6.
I think this is critical, isn't it? Because the document that you published yesterday ahead of you coming to committee doesn't have any data in it in terms of this loss. It talks about the equalities audit that took place in January. And I think we would all want to see, the Parliament would want to see, and the country would want to see, that the response was based on what had happened. What has been lost? You know, what is the time that's lost? And it doesn't sound to me that you've got a full grasp of what that is. Maybe some things are forthcoming. That's great. But surely that has to be a response to actually what's happened. I worry that the government doesn't have a grasp of the scale of this challenge.
I can assure you we have an absolute grasp of the scale of the challenge on this. We are speaking regularly, as the committee would expect, to teacher unions who give feedback about what is happening in their classrooms. We're speaking directly to young people themselves on this. We do have a monitoring and evaluation progress programme that is well established around improvement in attainment and well-being. I've mentioned some of the areas around this. They will report in due course. But again, that goes back to the point about why we're not waiting and why the material that we're doing to support young people in terms of additional teachers, of the additional funding that's already going in, hasn't waited. It's already being actioned because we know that there has been an impact on attainment, and we know there's been an impact. Well, if you forgive me, Mr. Marrett, there's timings for when those reports come out so the data can be collated. I don't need the report to come out to know there's been an impact, which is why the government came in and has already ensured that we're putting in place additional teachers, that we're putting in place the additional pupil equity funding, for example, to support around COVID. So we've not waited. We're already taking action. So with the greatest respect, we can't be criticised for a report on education recovery being told that actually there's nothing new in it, and then being told actually, well, you shouldn't wait. We haven't waited. We've already taken action. And when the further material comes out, for example, around health and well-being, or the next data that will happen around curriculum for excellence levels, of course at that point we will ensure and self-check. So it's an ongoing process. This isn't a point in time, because as I think I've kept stated, you know, schools are still in the midst of dealing with the pandemic. So I'm not going to just look at what's happening last year. I'm going to look at what's continuing to happen, and the government will adapt its progress accordingly.
Thanks, Kabir.
Michael Mara. There's a couple of supplementaries on this. First, I'm going to call on Bob Doris and then Stephanie Callaghan. I know colleagues will be mindful of time.
It will be very brief. It's on the agreement between the SQA and the Equality and Human Rights Commission for Scotland that Mr. Mara was referring to. I note the EHRC was very positive about the two-year agreement to drive up standards, and they believe that will happen, but Lynn Welsh from EHRC also says this agreement sends a clear message to other public bodies that considering the impact of their work on people from protected groups is critical in fulfilling their legal duties. And that's really important to put on the record here today as well. Can I ask what the Scottish Government's doing to make sure that public bodies across Scotland learn the lessons from the SQA experience and drive up their standards as well?
Well, it is an area that we absolutely need to ensure is working not just well, but to the standard that people would expect it to. That's exactly why we've undertaken as part of the programme for government to take forward an implementation of equality and human rights mainstreaming strategies to ensure that is being looked at as thoroughly as the committee would expect. And I'm sure there are lessons that can be learned from what's happened within the SQA about ensuring that historical policies and practices at that time, if they are found, are dealt with expeditiously.
Thanks, Kavir. I hope that was brief enough.
That was very good. And then Stephanie.
Thank you, Convener. It was just to pick up on the comments around wellbeing, confidence of children as well. Michael was talking about data there. I know the Audit Scotland report on education outcomes noted that better data is needed to understand if outcomes like wellbeing and confidence are improving. You mentioned that there's a survey coming out in December there, and I'm just wondering what plans there are to work with stakeholders to develop and publish kind of consistent, robust data national data that reflects these priorities, so health, wellbeing, confidence there. Will that be built into the national framework as well? Will that be updated to reflect this data and the fact that it is a priority and if it impacts outcomes? Thanks.
So it is something that we absolutely do need to look at and to ensure, as I think I said earlier, we're gathering the correct data over the correct areas. And that is challenging in some areas of curriculum for excellence more than others, but we need to be up to that challenge. There will be a review of the National Improvement Framework measurements in 2022. So that will allow stakeholders to be able to assess with government how we've measured for the NIF in the past. Is that correct? What needs to change? And if so, what would they like to change that to? And areas around health and wellbeing are, of course, already part of our analysis. But I think it's the right time as we move out of COVID to ensure that we're doing that correctly. But that will be a consultation that will happen early next year.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to now go to James Dornan and then Fergus will follow James. James Dornan.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to you, Cabinet Secretary. I want to ask you a couple of questions around the OECD report. In general, it was a very positive report, but there's a number of areas were raised by the OECD around room for improvement by the Scottish Government, and I'm just wondering, have you reflected on your approach? And if so, can you tell us how you've reflected on this?
So I think, first of all, I should say that the OECD report was very welcome and very timely. We have accepted in full all the recommendations of that review, and I'll be making further announcements about more detail of how we'll take forward that implementation in due course. I think one of the aspects which came through loud and clear in the report was that there was wide support for curriculum for excellence, and you know, there was a quote, for example, in that it continues to be a bold and widely supported initiative, and its design offers the flexibility needed to improve student learning further. So I think that the foundations that we have are correct. Professor Stober, in his report, said that this was an inspiring example equated with good curriculum practice. So we have good foundations to build on. I think, understandably, as we look to curriculum for excellence, it has been in place for some time now. So it is quite right that the OECD have challenged the government to see what more can be done to make sure that it is fit for purpose, and that's exactly what I'll be saying more about in due course, to exactly how we can ensure that it's right for the challenges that we have ahead. I think that's timely for us to do that, given the fact it's been in place for more than a decade, and not surprising that there would be changes that would need to be made.
Thank you for that, but further to that then, given that you've got this, you're going to be giving a statement at some stage, I suspect. Will your implementation of the report reflect the OECD's suggested approach?
So we'll absolutely look very carefully at what the OECD have recommended in it. I think one of the challenges that we'll have when we're taking the report forward is that there is a lot in it, and there is a lot of change, some of which can happen at the same time, and some of which will have to happen within different timescales. Again, part of the reason for that is that some of this change, if it's going to be done in a collaborative fashion, as I believe it should be, with stakeholders, will take some time for us to work collaboratively with stakeholders to actually get the details of that correct. So there is a lot to do. There is some work that we can undertake quite quickly on this. There are some areas, I say, that will take time. So one of the issues which I'm looking at when I look to make further announcements on this is to try and set out What we can do in the short term and to highlight the areas that will take longer. And I think that's part of the areas about what the OECD looked at in terms of their suggestions about how to take this forward, the time that it takes to take it forward and also the manner. And that's, I think, exceptionally important. As I said in earlier remarks, I am determined to play a really collaborative role as Education Secretary. The committee, the Parliament, will decide, how it wants to take forward, if any, work on these issues. But I'd be more than, happy to work with anyone and everyone who has a role, because there are a number of challenges within that report, and they can't all be done at once or quickly.
Just finally, on a slightly different point, still to do with the OECD, how have the impacts in college and training sectors been factored into any responses that you've made to date?
Yeah, it is an important issue that we look at this in the round, particularly when we look at the senior phase, because we have school-college partnerships that are exceptionally important and becoming even more so. So one of the areas, for example, where I would hope it demonstrates how we are linking in with the colleges around this is the fact that College of Scotland have been invited onto the Scottish Education Council. They weren't there previously, and that I hope demonstrates our commitment to look at this in the round and to recognise that we can't just look at what happens within schools, but when we're looking at attainment and achievement, we need to look at that in a wider sense, and colleges play a very important role in that.
And that's the sort of the method you'll be taking forward then?
Well, it is one of the areas where I'm keen that we can attempt to build consensus as far as possible in education, is around the refreshed and reformed Scottish Education Council. It's quite a large body, but it does bring together representatives from local governments, from some of the trade unions. Importantly, within the refreshed Scottish Education Council, more children and young people and more children and young people's representatives, rights representatives, to be able to have that type of discussion.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, James. Fergus Ewing.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. In the evidence we heard from the OECD, there were a great deal of positive endorsements of the quality of education in Scotland. I haven't time to run through them all, but they did find that we were a leading country in global competency proficiency, that we produce confident and articulate children from our education system, that there's good partnerships between universities and schools, and that the Curriculum for Excellence has expanded opportunities. So I wanted to focus on what I took, Cabinet Secretary, to be their sort of central criticism, which was that given that we have the four competencies in the CFE of producing successful learners, confident individuals, responsible citizens, and effective contributors, what I took to be their central criticism was that the system as it is doesn't provide it necessarily a means of assessing and ensuring that each of these four competencies can be achieved. Now, that was simply what I took from it. It may not be your view, but I wanted this morning to ask you three questions. And the first really is, do you think I've accurately described the central thrust of their criticism? And in particular, how, in practice, do you think that it can be... successful learners, confident individuals, responsible citizens, and effective contributors. But also we have a means of demonstrating that, which is seen as reliable, objective, and fair.
Did the Cabinet Secretary catch that? Did you get a sense of...
I think so. Mr Ewing, I'm sure, will correct me if I've missed a point, because it did glitch out as part of his question there, but he'll keep me right, no doubt. I think one of the areas that I have found refreshing when being Education Secretary is having some of the discussions with the OECD and taking part in discussions with the International Council of Education Advisors, and indeed taken part in some webinars that have been organised by the OECD, and with a global audience discussing the successes of Scottish education and particularly of Curriculum for Excellence. I don't sit here as the Education Secretary and say there is nothing that we need to improve on or that we can't do better, but it is refreshing, I think, to have a global perspective on Scottish education. And I think the positive points that Mr. Ewing alluded to at the start is certainly something which has came through very strongly in the webinars that I have attended from colleagues across the globe. One of the areas where the OECD have quite rightly challenged us is around how our broad general education fits or does not fit with our senior phase, and within that the assessments and qualifications setup that we have at the moment. And that is something that I am giving a great deal of thought to. I know various members of the committee have some strongly held opinions on this issue as well. It is one of the areas where I will be making further announcements in due course about what we will do about this when I respond to the OECD, because we have been given a challenge by them that the Curriculum for Excellence does need to have work done to ensure that it's ready for the challenges that we have ahead as a society. But I think one of the biggest challenges the OECD did give us was how to make sure that Curriculum for Excellence flows all the way through to the senior phase. How we do that, which was the bit at the end of Mr. Ewing's question that I did get, was around ensuring that this is reliable and a credible system, and that absolutely has to be the case. However, we have a qualifications and assessments process. It does have to be reliable and credible. There are different ways you can have that type of process and allow it to be reliable and credible. We can make changes to what's there currently. But again, I would stress this is one of the areas where we will take forward discussions with stakeholders, because there are a variety of views about how that can be done. And I would like to build in as much collaboration and consensus about this as possible.
Well, I'm very happy with that answer, Convener, and I look forward to further details and the statement. And I do hope it's something the Cabinet Secretary can give even more consideration of, because of the importance of ensuring that that people in colleges, universities, business, the adult world can have full confidence in the validity of the awards that we issue to children through the processes that we employ. The second of the three questions I wanted to ask was actually about that, because obviously with the massive disruption that lockdown has caused, we've had to do things differently, and examinations have been made way for the use of assessment in general. And I just wonder what the Cabinet Secretary's view is and to this question. How can we ensure that the outside world, the adult world, if you like, have confidence and can place confidence in the accuracy of the gradings, the results that flow from an assessment process, which we've had to have of necessity over lockdown these past 2 years, essentially, as opposed to traditional examinations? And can she reassure, if you like, the adult world about the value and the confidence that we can place in those results and awards?
So it is a very important area around ensuring credibility within the process. And the last 2 years have been like no others that we can, you know, we could have imagined or planned for when it came to what happened with the exams. One of the issues and points that I raised earlier was around the professional judgment of our teachers, and that came to the fore over the past few years. And I think that proved that there are different ways of doing an assessment process that can lead to a qualification, and that qualification is still a credible qualification. And I think more importantly than maybe taking my word for it or even taking the SQA's word for it, although that is their absolutely one of their guiding principles, is to ensure the credibility of the process, and they worked exceptionally hard to allow that to happen. It was around how this was received by employers, and I was really heartened to see a letter that went out that was, I think, led by Sandy Begbie, but absolutely signed by many other employers, which credited our children and young people for going through a process that might have been different, but those children and young people have faced challenges like no other year, and that therefore really did ensure that employers had faith in what young people were receiving at the end of that day, because they have done so, as I say, facing challenges like none of the rest of us ever did when we were going through our exams, no matter how long ago that was. And again, I would pay tribute to the university sector during this as well. They worked exceptionally closely with government and with the SQA to have an understanding about what the process was, so that again they could have faith in that as they were looking to their entry requirements. So the way I think that both the universities and employers reacted to it demonstrates that there was credibility in what happened over the past couple of years, and that you can have a credible system doing the assessment in different ways.
Well, thank you, and I hope and I imagine that the Cabinet Secretary will, in her discussions with everybody involved, include the business world to ensure that they're confident about the way ahead, the Chambers of Commerce, the FSB, the Council of Development Industry, Institute Directors and so on, because I think it's important to get the buy-in and to show that we have an excellent system in which they can place confidence. The last of the three questions I wanted to ask was slightly different and maybe a bit left field, Cabinet Secretary, but don't look too worried, because it arose from something you mentioned at the beginning, namely the pledge that every child should have either a laptop or a tablet. And I welcome this, although I suspect many children already have such devices, but it's important that we reach out to all, particularly those who are not able to afford such devices. So I welcome that pledge, which the Deputy First Minister made earlier this year, I believe. However, a laptop and tablet is simply a tool to be used. In itself, it doesn't achieve anything. And I wondered in particular if the Cabinet Secretary agrees with me that one skill which it would be extremely useful to enable children to acquire is the appropriate use of touch typing using the QWERTY keyboard on a laptop or tablet. Given that, speaking personally, there's many things I've completely failed to do in life, like foreign languages, so that was my fault. But I did have the opportunity from a friend of my mother's, actually, to learn how to touch type. And frankly, the most useful thing I've ever learned in terms of skills in life. And, you know, when I see children tapping away at a mobile phone with two fingers, I think this is not great, because it doesn't really equip you for the many, many walks of life where the ability to type effectively and quickly is an extraordinary benefit, not least in our own world, but in just about every area where communication using the written word is appropriate. I'm asking the question at some length so that the Cabinet Secretary has ample time to compose her answer. But to be serious, I do think it's, maybe it's just me, but I do think it's an extremely useful skill. And I wonder if the tool that the tablet and the iPad is can be made really useful by enabling children to learn how to touch type with a skill that will really perhaps transform what they can get out of their employment and their life in general.
You're correct, Mr. Ewing. That is a bit of a left field question. I shall do my best to answer it. I think you do raise an important point. The member raises a really important point about the use of technology and how it's not simply about having a device. I'll broaden this out slightly and talk about the connectivity, which is important to have as well, but it's also important about the use of that technology. So I'm being reassured that the experiences and outcomes includes the use of technology as well. It may not go as far as Mr. Ewing wishes on touch typing in particular, but I hope I've given them some reassurance as much as I can today that the use of technology is something which is in the E's and O's within the technology.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We've just, if we can continue just slightly longer, we've got a couple of other questions. Willie Rennie.
What evidence have you gathered to justify the inclusion of children's services in the National Care Service?
So this is an area that's obviously still up for consultation. On this, clearly the Feely Review looked at adult services as part of this, but there is a concern that having adult services within a National Care Service and having children's services separate will lead to more difficult transitions, challenges as we go through that process. So one of the areas we are genuinely keen to seek people's views on, because I know there will be different views on this as we look to the National Care Service, is how do we get the best outcomes for children out of that, and particularly with a view to transition as well. So it's part of a consultation. The government hasn't taken a view on this, as I hope he would expect, given the consultation is still live. And we'll, of course, analyse the material that comes from that. But there is, I think, an understandable body of opinion that believes having adult services separate to children's services would be detrimental to how that system's raised. I appreciate it's one body of opinion, there are others, but that's currently the position that we're looking at the moment.
I mean, do you accept it appears like it's an afterthought? It wasn't included in the Feely report. There wasn't an equivalent report of the Feely report. Fiona Duncan from The Promise has expressed, I would classify it as real concern. So is it an afterthought, or have you actually gathered evidence on this?
Well, it's not an afterthought. I think if we go back to when the Feely Review was established, there was a clear need for that and a drive for that at that time, given some of the issues that have been shown up through the pandemic. When we're looking at this, obviously the adult care services are there, but we do need to check whether we can provide consistent delivery of services to what are the most vulnerable children and young people that we have. And also realising that a number of children and young people that are have contact, for example, with social work services, do so because they may have an adult family member who is also receiving support within adult services. So again, does it make sense for those to be more seamless than they would be if they were separate? So it's very much not an afterthought by any manner of means at all. I think what we've seen from Fiona Duncan and others is quite likely they are challenging as to make sure that there are no unintended consequences, no gaps, and how we would be able to deliver on the promise. How best did we deliver on the promise? I think that's the right challenge to give to government, and that's absolutely something that we will be looking at very, very closely as we move out of the consultation and analyse the discussions that come from that, or the recommendations that come from that, from different bodies who, again, may have very different opinions on this.
So my final question is, are you delivering the promise?
Well, the whole point of the promise was it was never going to be an overnight challenge for government to say, no, we're not, yes, we are. I think we are making good progress on the promise. I think the work that the government has taken on the promise has ensured we are looking at things in a different way. So this was never going to be something that could be done overnight, but I think we are making good progress to that, and we are absolutely determined to deliver for every child and young person that is a part of the care system for that. That is absolutely our determination and obligation to do just that.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Just before we conclude, thank you very much for the time you've given us this morning. Can I ask you a couple of quick questions? First one is, what study is being done into the impact on the physical and mental health of young people by having to wear face coverings for the protracted periods that our people at school, young people at school, are having to wear them?
So the evidence on face coverings is something that's looked at by our subgroup, which particularly looks at all the mitigation measures that are part of our COVID strategy. That's something which they regularly review. The subgroup met again yesterday, and I await their updated suggestions from that, which we'll discuss at the Education Recovery Group. So the subgroup looks at a four harms approach, as we do for all our aspects around this, around both the direct impact of COVID, indirect health method issues, and also issues around health and wellbeing. So that's the role of the subgroup, to provide the advice on that basis. Sure I will be receiving advice from them, which we'll discuss tomorrow at CERG.
You haven't received anything from them yet about the impact this is having on young people, the conditions in which they're attending school?
Well, I've received their previous advice, but what I'm saying is...
What did it say?
Their advice, looking at a four harms approach, was that given the fact that one of our main concerns was to reduce the disruption to children's education through prolonged periods off school...
Sure, but what about the actual young people themselves? What is it saying it's doing to them, that they have to wear these face coverings for many, many hours a day?
Well, as I said, what they're looking at is the four harms approach as a whole, and one of the keys was around the disruption to learning. So the subgroup have advised that the mitigations that should be in place at our schools at the moment does include face coverings, because their balance of that four harms approach was that face masks are an important mitigation measure to allow less disruption within schools, which had a major impact on children's health and wellbeing.
I get all that. I'm just asking really what the impact is on the young people, but maybe you'll come back and tell us what the actual impact, mental and physical health impact, of that measure is, because there is one, I think. How much will it cost to make all these structural changes to the SQA? Nowhere does it say how much has been set aside or it's anticipated that it's going to cost to replace the SQA. What is your expectation on how much you will need to be able to carry out this reform?
So what we will have is, in effect, a new agency. So the SQA will be replaced and there will be another body in that. So clearly at that point, we will not have the SQA, we will have a different body. What that will look like, I think, is very, very importantly being left to Ken Muir in an independent review on this process. So at this point, the exact makeup of that agency is something for Mr. Muir to have a look at, to be able to give their recommendations. The functions that, in essence, he is looking at are in many ways being carried out by different parts of government. So what he's looking at is what should, for example, go into the replacement of the SQA, where should inspections go to. So it's where functions sit. We're not inventing necessarily new functions.
No, but there will be costs, won't there? I mean, all these things carry costs with them, inevitably. So...
Well, what I'm saying is that we already carry out functions around curriculum. We already
so there might
carry
be savings,
out...
then?
Well, that very much depends on what Mr. Muir comes forward with. But I don't see this as part of an expensive process, because we're not inventing new agencies for the sake of it. We're challenging ourselves to make sure that the structures, the functions, and very, very importantly within that, the cultures of those organisations are fit for purpose.
And my final question is, as you will be aware, the Supreme Court this morning has unanimously decided to that the four provisions of the UNCR UNCRC bill and two provisions of the European Charter of Local Self-Government are outside the competence of this Parliament. When did your office first receive legal advice that this was the most likely outcome of this case?
Well, as you'll appreciate, Convener, the discussions around this have been ongoing for some time, but the judgment of the Supreme Court has literally came out while I've been at committee.
Yes.
I understand the Deputy First Minister is making a statement to Parliament,
yes.
So if I can perhaps refer committee to the Deputy First Minister's statement and the chance to ask questions then,
because I have
not had the opportunity to be able to analyse what's been made public while I've been at committee.
But you will be able to tell us at some future point when your office first received legal advice that this was the most likely outcome.
I'm sure if that's a question that the convener wishes to ask the Deputy First Minister later on, as he has opportunity to get into this in much more detail than I do today,
okay.
I'm sure the Deputy First Minister would be delighted to answer.
Cabinet Secretary, once again, thanks to you and to Graeme Logan for joining us this morning. Today's meeting is now at an end, and Parliament will now be in recess for 2 weeks. So our next meeting will therefore be on Wednesday, the 27th of October. I formally close the meeting.